Bonjour à tous, bienvenue pour cette seconde journée consacrée aux échanges franco-américains sur Spinoza. Je suis d'autant plus heureuse de vous accueillir ici que c'est dans cette salle que pour la première fois a été mis en place ce principe d'échange et de réponse. Le premier échange était un échange franco-italien qui a donné lieu à une publication Spinoza transalpin. Alors nous espérons réitérer la chose et nous sommes vraiment ravis de vous avoir tous parmi nous. Je voudrais en particulier remercier Charles Ramon et Jacques Setter qui ont été à l'initiative de cette deuxième série de rencontres internationales et nous espérons qu'il y aura une longue suite et que ça fera des émules. Je voudrais remercier également Pascal Sebrac qui est co-organisateur avec l'Université de Paris 12 et Pierre-François Moreau. Alors, sans plus tarder, je vais donner la parole à Edwin Curley, mais je voudrais préciser également avant que si vous souhaitez pouvoir vous connecter pour avoir les textes en ligne, je vais vous envoyer un mail à Charles Ramon.
Mais tous les textes sont imprimés en 50 exemplaires, donc il n'y aura pas de problème.
Les textes sont imprimés, donc pour ceux qui auraient besoin, donc l'adresse de Charles, donc Ramon, R-A-M-O-N-D, point Charles, @ orange.fr.
Merci. So, this works. This works. Okay. Okay, it's my pleasure this morning to introduce Micah Del Roca, who will be speaking on strands of idealism. It's the elusiveness of the one and the many in Spinoza, substance, attribute, and mode.
Okay.
Is this working now? Okay.
Good morning. Thank you for Ed, for the introduction. Thank you for organizing this wonderful conference, all of you. I think it's been a wonderful occasion to meet old friends and to make new friends. It's really been a great day yesterday, and I hope that today will be a great day, too.
Could you speak into the mic?
Into the mic, okay. Very close.
Thank you.
Okay, so what I'm going to do is go through a lot of this paper. Don't worry, I won't read the whole paper that you may have seen. I won't have time to do that. I've shortened it. In particular, I probably will not talk much about the last section of the paper, and I'll be cutting parts as we go along. But I hope to get through a lot of the paper and have a really good discussion afterwards. And I also want to say that the comments from Pascal, which I've read in advance, are wonderful. He raises a lot of great questions, and I look forward to the discussion of those questions too. Okay, so let's begin. Different dimensions of idealism, it might be thought, shape Spinoza's work. Perhaps the most fundamental is the strand of idealism according to which all that exists is somehow dependent on thought. Such an idealism, I've argued elsewhere, is more or less dictated by Spinoza's commitment to the principle of sufficient reason, the PSR, a thesis which I unapologetically see as providing the key to much of Spinoza's thought. I should like here, however, to focus on possibly two other strands of idealism or apparent strands that might be found in Spinoza. The first of these other strands of idealism concerns the attributes of substance. On this view, contrary to what many interpreters have thought, the attributes are not many, but are rather the same. There is no distinction among the attributes, no genuine multiplicity. Instead, any distinction here is some kind of illusion, somehow dependent on our minds. It is this appeal to the mind dependence of any distinction among the attributes that shows that this strand of idealism is in keeping with the general and fundamental view that all things are thought dependent. Now, this kind of idealism is found prominently, of course, in Hegel's interpretation of Spinoza and in Hegelian interpreters such as Harold Joachim and other British idealists. The British idealists are very close to my heart, and so I'm glad to speak in their favor today. Now, this reading is also widely associated with the so-called subjectivist view of the attributes, a view prominently espoused by Harry Wolfson. Now, there's been much criticism of the subjectivist view in the literature, And this is not surprising, for there is substantial apparent textual evidence against such a reading. I, too, have also taken a ride on this anti-Wolfson bandwagon, this critical endeavor against Wolfson. But one of my goals in the paper is to atone for the sins of the unfounded criticisms I've made against Wolfson in the past. I think part of what I want to do today is to show actually what is right in Wolfson's interpretation and what is still wrong in Wolfson's interpretation. So I want to have a more balanced view in this paper. I'll probably end on that note today in the presentation. The second particular strand of idealism also turns on an alleged differentiation within substance. Here, the apparent differentiation concerns not attributes, but modes. On the standard realist, non-idealist view, modes are genuinely different from other modes. On a non-realist or on an idealist understanding of modes, the distinction among modes is, again, illusory and somehow mind-dependent. This understanding of modes is, of course, to be found in the so-called acosmist reading of Spinoza, to be found in Hegel and in Maimon, and in followers of Hegel among Spinoza commentators. Now, my general plan in this paper is to identify in a new way the grounds of Spinoza's views on number, on oneness, and on manyness, and in so doing, to offer new support for reading Spinoza as adopting at least some of the strands of idealism that have been attributed to him. So here in the first section of the paper, conflicting texts. Now, I begin not with attributes or with modes, where the debate over idealism has been the most intense, but I begin with substance, where there has been somewhat less strife over the issue of multiplicity. Now, it's clear that in some sense, for Spinoza, God is the only substance. After all, Spinoza says explicitly in 1P14, Corollary 1, God is unique, that is, there is only one substance. And there are other statements of that, of course, in Spinoza's corpus. However, as Moens, who is here today, happily, as Moens has helpfully stressed in a recent excellent paper, Spinoza on at least two occasions evinces, he manifests hesitation about saying that God is one and that God is the only substance. First, in Spinoza's Cogitata Metaphysica, immediately after saying that God is unique and that there cannot be more than one of the same nature as God, Spinoza seems to take this back. He says, if we wish to examine the matter more accurately, we could perhaps show that God is only improperly called one and unique. Spinoza also says in a letter that, of course, a lot of people have made a lot of, and I want to make a lot of too, letter 50, this is a letter which is very brief, but it's also very significant for idealist readings of Spinoza and also for the subsequent philosophy of mathematics. He says in this letter, he says, it is certain that he who calls God one or unique has no true idea of God or is speaking of him only very improperly. Now, these sentiments in these passages by Spinoza have long made me uneasy, for it has been unclear to me how to incorporate them into a general understanding of Spinoza's substance monism. Moen's paper makes great strides in this connection, and that paper enriches the treatment of number and of Spinoza's monism. Now, I aim in my paper today to go beyond Moen's paper in three ways. First, I will articulate the philosophical underpinnings of Spinoza's conception of number at work in the passages that I and Moen's have emphasized. Second, I will demonstrate the significance of these passages not only for Spinoza's conception of the oneness of substance, but also for his conception of the manyness of attributes and of modes, although I won't probably have time to say a lot about modes today. Finally, throughout the paper, I will emphasize the connection between the notion of number and oneness at work in Spinoza and the understanding of Spinoza as an idealist. Okay, so now section two, number and essence. So let's examine Spinoza's conception of number before returning to substance and then going on to discuss at least attributes. For Spinoza, to number things, to see them as one or many, is to regard the things in question as members of a class or kind. And this is evident in a famous passage which I won't read right now, because you don't have time, a famous passage from Letter 50, in which Spinoza articulates this view, that to number things is to put them in a class or a kind. Now, why should it be the case that to count, to number a thing or things, is to see them as belonging to a class? To see what's involved here, what's driving Spinoza, consider what would be the case if we say, if we saw certain things as many, and we numbered them, but did not see them as forming a class. That is, if we did not number them in part because they fell under a common type. Without seeing the object as sharing this common feature or as belonging to a single class, it seems that our counting just these objects would be arbitrary. This would offend against Spinoza's rationalism, against his rejection of brute facts, against his rejection of arbitrary facts. So that's why I think that Spinoza thinks that we have to see things, when we number them, we see them as falling under a class. But there is a further crucial dimension of Spinoza's thought about what it is to assign a number to a thing. Not only must we see the numbered items as sharing a certain property or as belonging to a certain class, it must also be the case that that property is the essence or nature of those things. In other words, for Spinoza, to assign a number to a thing is to see it as belonging to a class of things whose members share the same essence or nature. So I'm claiming that for Spinoza, when one numbers a thing, the class to which one sees the thing as belonging is a class of things that share the same nature as a thing. And when he says that a number thing must agree with other things, he means that it must agree with those other things in nature. If the class in terms of which things are numbered could be a class of things that do not share the same nature, then it is no longer clear why God could not be numbered. After all, God can be seen as falling into the same class as some other things. For example, God and my body both have the property of being extended, right? This property is not the nature of either me or of God. My body's nature is to have a certain proportion of motion and rest, perhaps. God's nature is to consist of an infinity of attributes, each of which expresses an eternal and infinite essence. That's the definition of God. Now, if the classes that Spinoza is interested in Letter 50 are not classes of things of the same nature, then it's no longer clear why God cannot be numbered. So for Spinoza, the common class under which a numbered thing falls must be a class of things of the same nature. Why, however, would Spinoza place such a strong requirement on what it is to consider a thing numerically? This is not at all an intuitive requirement. I think that Spinoza's view that to think of a thing in terms of number requires conceiving of it as sharing an essence follows from the fact that for Spinoza, to conceive of a thing, one must conceive of it in terms of its essence. This is what I have elsewhere called Spinoza's essence requirement on representation. It's a requirement that in order to conceive of anything, any particular thing, including God, one must conceive of it, think of it in terms of its essence. It's the essence of a thing. It's by grasping the essence, that's what enables us to refer to the thing, to represent it, to pick it out in thought. And there's various reasons for thinking that Spinoza holds that view. We won't have time to go into that there. The reasons turn for me, the reasons for the essence requirement turn for me on two fundamental features in Spinoza's system, his principle of sufficient reason, and his view that there's an explanatory or conceptual barrier between the attributes. That's what's driving, I think, the essence requirement and representation. But I'm going to skip the discussion of the motivations and the textual basis for the essence requirement, and this show what the implications for that requirement are for Spinoza's understanding of number. So the essence requirement helps us to see, helps us to understand why Spinoza holds that to regard a thing numerically is to regard it as a member of a class, all of whose members share the same essence. Since to represent a thing in terms of number is to see it as belonging to a certain class whose members share a certain property, and since to represent a thing is to represent it as having a certain essence, to represent a thing, then, in terms of number, is to represent it as belonging to a certain class, all of whose members share that essence. If the class in terms of which we enumerate a thing were a class of things that did not share the essence of that thing, of the thing in question, then we would, in enumerating the thing, be seeing it in terms of a feature other than its essence, and thus we would be violating the essence requirements and representation. One might think, perhaps, that we can first secure reference to a thing by thinking of it in terms of its essence, just as the essence requirement specifies, and then we can go on to enumerate that thing by focusing on some further property that does not constitute its essence, but that it shares with other things. In this way, the shared property need not be the essence of the thing that is enumerated. This two-step strategy would not, however, avoid the problem at hand, for to the extent that one is focusing on the non-essential property, then, given the essence requirement, one is no longer genuinely representing the object. In moving to a focus on the shared property, one loses one's focus on the essence of the object, one abstracts in a way, and one's thought that is employed in the attempted enumeration is thus no longer really a thought about the object in question. Again, the essence requirement would be violated. In this light, we can see how Spinoza's theory of number, according to which to regard something numerically is to regard the thing as one of many of the same nature, is grounded in Spinoza's views on what is required to represent a thing, which in turn are, as I've indicated, grounded in his fundamental commitment to the PSR, the principle of sufficient reason, and in his explanatory separation between the attributes. Okay, so now we're in section 3 of the paper, number and substance. So let's think about what it is to see God or substance numerically. That is, to see God as one of many. That's what it is to number something for Spinoza. And for Spinoza, and given that account of number, this is to see God as one of many that share the same nature. But for Spinoza, nothing but God can have the nature that God has. God's nature, as I mentioned before, is to be a substance consisting of an infinity of attributes. No other thing can have that nature, of course. Nothing can share God's nature. So God thus cannot be seen in terms of number. God cannot be one, for God cannot be one of many of the same nature. How then are we to make sense of Spinoza's claim that God is one and that there is only one substance, namely God? It may help here to distinguish between a strict or a proper sense of one and a loose or improper sense of the word one. That Spinoza would recognize some such distinction is apparent from his speaking on two occasions of improperly calling God one. Now, this suggests that some kind of proper-improper distinction is available in this context. To say that a thing is one presupposes that it exists. Further, the reason that God is not properly called one is that despite the fact that God exists, there are not many of the same nature as God. This suggests, and this is on your handout too, this suggests the following characterization of being one in the proper sense, or one P, as I will say sometimes. So a thing is one, a thing X is one in the proper sense, one P, just in case that thing X exists, and there are others of the same nature as X. Now, in light of this characterization, we can say that for Spinoza, God is not one in the proper sense. God is not one P. However, in the passages leading up to Spinoza's claim in the first corollary of Proposition 14 of Part 1, leading up to that, we saw, leading up to the claim that God is one, Spinoza establishes that there are no other substances or other things of the same nature as God. This foundation for his claim of oneness in the corollary to Proposition 14, and this foundation for that claim of oneness, a claim which he elsewhere labels as improper, this indicates that the improper sense of one can be characterized this way. So this is one in the improper sense, or one I. X is one in the improper sense, just in case X exists, and it is not the case that there are other things of the same nature as X. Notice that the proper and improper senses of the word one are differentiated by the fact that the final conjunct in one characterization is the negation of the final conjunct in the other characterization. That is, the characterizations differ in that the conjunct in one characterization concerning whether or not things are of the same nature is negated in the other characterization. This kind of difference between proper and improper senses will be repeated in other contexts, as we'll soon see. Now, before we turn to other similar notions with proper and improper senses in Spinoza, I want to point out that just as God is one I, that is one in the improper sense, and not one P, one in the proper sense, so too the extended substance is one I and not one P, not one in the proper sense. The extended substance is not one P, one in the proper sense, because although the extended substance exists, there are no others of the same nature as the extended substance. The nature of the extended substance is simply the attribute of extension. That's what the no shared attribute shows. And nothing else has, no other substance has the attribute of extension. Thus, the extended substance is not one P. But the extended substance is one in the improper sense, for it exists, and as we've just seen, there are no others of the same nature. Similarly, the thinking substance is one in the improper sense, but not one P. If the essence or nature of the extended substance is extension, and if the essence of God is, as we saw, to consist of an infinity of attributes, how then are God and the extended substance related? Are they the same or not? And how are their essences related? Are they the same or not? It is to this kind of question that I now turn. Spinoza often speaks of things as being one and the same. I've spent a lot of my career discussing this phrase, one and the same, in Spinoza. So he often speaks of things being one and the same. Now, given the presence of the term one in this phrase, and given the proper-improper distinction that we have just outlined with regard to the term one, we'd expect, it seems natural, to expect a similar ambiguity in the case of the phrase one and the same. That is, we would expect that there would be in Spinoza a commitment to proper and improper senses of one and the same. Similarly, given the ambiguity of one and the same, and given that many can be seen as the opposite of one and the same, we would expect there to be proper and improper senses of the term many, as well as of the term one and the same. Further, given their opposition, we would expect one and the same and many to be characterizable in terms of each other. In this light, how are we to characterize the claim that X and Y are one and the same, any two things, X and Y are one and the same? Let's focus first on the proper sense of this term one and the same. In order for X and Y to be one and the same P in the proper sense, X and Y must both exist. That's the first point to mention. The second point is that since, as I noted, one and the same is the opposite of many, we can say that if X and Y are one and the same in the proper sense, they are not many in the proper sense. And to complete the characterization of one and the same in the proper sense, note that one and the same can be seen as a numerical notion, and that, as we saw, to see things in terms of number is, for Spinoza, to see them as sharing a nature with other things. One way to see X and Y in the numerical terms indicated by one and the same is thus to see X and Y as of the same nature. So in this light, with this lead-up, here's a characterization of being one and the same in the proper sense. This is one and the same P. X and Y are one and the same in the proper sense, just in case X and Y exist, X and Y are not many in the proper sense, and X and Y are of the same nature. In the same vein, we can characterize what it is to be many in the proper sense. Recall that one and the same and many are opposites, and so it is natural for them to be characterized in terms of each other. With these features in mind, we can say the following. This is many in the proper sense. X and Y are many in the proper sense, just in case X and Y exist. X and Y are not one and the same in the proper sense, and just in case X and Y are of the same nature. Now, to arrive at the improper senses of one and the same and of many, recall that the improper sense of one differed from the proper sense of one only insofar as the conjunct concerning whether there are things of the same nature is affirmed in the characterization of one sense and denied in the other. In this light, the characterization of the improper senses of one and the same and of many would be the following, and this is also on the handout. One and the same, I, are improper. X and Y are one and the same in the improper sense, just in case X and Y exist. X and Y are not many in the proper sense, and it is not the case that X and Y are of the same nature. And correspondingly, X and Y are many in the improper sense, just in case X and Y exist. X and Y are not one and the same in the proper sense, and it is not the case that X and Y are of the same nature. With these distinctions in mind, between proper and improper senses of one and the same and of many, let's consider the relation between the thinking substance and the extended substance and God. Consider first the thinking substance and the extended substance. They are not one and the same in the proper sense because the thinking substance and the extended substance differ in nature. The nature of the thinking substance is just thought, and the nature of the extended substance is just extension, and those substances can share attributes. Notice also that the thinking substance and the extended substance are not many in the proper sense. This is for the same reason that they are not one and the same, namely, that they are not of the same nature. But in light of the fact that the thinking substance and the extended substance are neither one and the same in the proper sense, nor many in the proper sense, we can reach the conclusion that the thinking substance and the extended substance are one and the same in the improper sense. Notice that all the relevant conjuncts are satisfied in this case. The thinking substance and the extended substance exist. They are not many in the proper sense, and it is not the case that they are of the same nature. So when Spinoza says in the Scholium to Proposition 7 of Part 2, when he says that the thinking substance and the extended substance are one and the same substance, what he says can be seen as true if one and the same is understood in the improper sense. But notice that while the thinking substance and the extended substance are one and the same in the improper sense, they are also many in the improper sense. For consider, the thinking substance and the extended substance exist. Also, they are not one and the same in the proper sense, as we've just seen, and it is not the case that they are of the same nature. In this light, we can see that God and the thinking substance are one and the same in the improper sense, but not one and the same in the proper sense. And we can see also that they are many in the improper sense, but not many in the proper sense. Similar claims apply to the relation between God and the extended substance, of course.
About 5 minutes.
Okay. So Spinoza's strictures concerning one and number and his distinction between proper and improper senses of one put his substance monism in an entirely new light. Just as God may be called one, only improperly, so too the thinking substance and the extended substance may be called one and the same, only improperly. And while the thinking substance and the extended substance are, properly speaking, not many, they may be called many in the improper sense, as well as one and the same in the improper sense. So let's move now to the section on attributes. Now, how much of this apparatus concerning number and one and the same applies to Spinoza's notion of attribute? It may seem obvious that there are many attributes for Spinoza. He defines God, as I've been mentioning, as consisting of an infinity of attributes. He seems to regard the attributes as genuinely distinct from each other in some sense. But although there may seem to be strong textual evidence against the view that there is no multiplicity of attributes for Spinoza, matters begin to look much different when we see the issue of multiplicity of attributes in light of Spinoza's general views about oneness and manyness. Indeed, given that Spinoza explicitly indicates that oneness and thus manyness are to be understood in different senses, we have no choice but to rethink Spinoza's apparent views on the manyness of attributes in light of these different senses. So before we apply the apparatus of one and many to the attributes, it's important to note that for Spinoza, the nature of an attribute is just that attribute itself. The nature of extension is just extension, and similarly for thought. There's evidence for that, but I'll skip over that for now. So let's ask the crucial question. Are thought and extension one and the same, or are they many? Again, we must approach this question in light of the distinction between proper and improper senses. And you can see again the relevant characterizations on your handout. Now, it's clear that thought and extension are neither one and the same in the proper sense, nor many in the proper sense. And this is because thought and extension do not share natures. The fact that the attributes are neither one and the same in the proper sense or many in the proper sense demonstrates that fundamentally, numerical concepts do not apply to attributes any more than they apply to substances. However, precisely because thought and extension are not of the same nature, and because they are not many in the proper sense, thought and extension are one and the same in the improper sense. And precisely because thought and extension are not of the same nature, and because they are not one and the same in the proper sense, thought and extension are many in the improper sense. Similarly, we can see that God and thought, for example, are not one and the same in the proper sense, or many in the proper sense, for they are of different natures. But God and thought are one and the same in the improper sense, and they are many in the improper sense. Similar points apply to the pair of God and extension. In general, in Spinoza's view, for the same reason that God is not properly called one, the attributes are not properly called many. Just as Spinoza is speaking improperly, as he acknowledges when he says that God is the only substance, so too he is speaking improperly when he says that there are different attributes and that there are infinitely many attributes. In general, number presupposing notions such as manyness, distinction, and being one and the same do not apply to attributes any more than they apply to substance or substances. Now, the final section I'm going to do is the partial rehabilitation of Wolfson. So in this light, let's return to the interpretations of Wolfson and of Hegel and idealist readers of Spinoza. Such interpreters have come under fire for saying that the attributes are the same, but we can now see that such attacks are importantly unfair, for in a certain respect, Wolfson is just right. Thought and extension are one and the same, at least in the improper sense of the term. And properly speaking, there is no multiplicity as far as the attributes are concerned, just as Wolfson says. Wolfson was also attacked for saying that the attributes are the same as God or substance, but here too he was right. Extension and God are one and the same, that is, in the improper sense. What Wolfson should have added, though, is that the attributes, in addition to being one and the same in the improper sense, are also not one and the same in the proper sense, and there are not many in the proper sense. Still, Wolfson is right in an important respect because the attributes are indeed one and the same in the improper sense. But there's an even deeper respect in which Wolfson and his conclusions are wrong. He says that the distinction of the attributes is invented by the mind. This is the crucial claim leading to his idealism, that the distinction between the attributes is invented by the mind. Hegel says similar things too. But by means of the framework that I have offered, we can see that in saying that attributes are distinct, we need not be guilty of any confused or inadequate thought. Yes, to say that thought and extension are many in the proper sense would be to think inadequately, simply because that's false. Notice, however, that thought and extension are not many in the proper sense, simply because thought and extension are of the same nature. So there is no reason to regard the thought that thought and extension are not many, P, as inadequate, right? Because they truly do not share the same nature. Equally, there is no reason to regard the thought and extension are many in the improper sense as inadequate. After all, to have this thought is just to think that thought and extension exist and are not one and the same in the proper sense, and that it is not the case that thought and extension are of the same nature. Each of these conjuncts is true, as we have seen. Thus, the attributes are the same in the improper sense, and to this extent, Wolfson is right. Nonetheless, he fails to acknowledge that it is equally true that the attributes are many in a sense, that is, improperly speaking. And perhaps even more significantly, he fails to see that in saying that the attributes are many in this sense, we are not taking part in any illusions of the intellect. To the extent that the idealist reading, as far as the attributes are concerned, is based on the supposition that claiming that attributes are many must be an illusion, such a reading is not well-grounded. We can still say that, for the reasons stemming from the PSR, everything is dependent on thought, because for a thing to exist is for it to be intelligible to an intellect in some way. So there's that general reason for idealism in Spinoza. But as far as the attributes are concerned, even though Wolfson is right that in a way, the attributes are one and the same, in a sense. He's wrong in thinking that that gives further reason to be an idealist. Now, in the last section of the paper, I talk about modes, and here I think the situation is importantly different. I won't go into this now, but with regard to modes, I think there is an illusion at the heart of what it is to be a mode, that modes are not many in the proper sense, not one and the same in the proper sense, but they are in the improper sense. But what it is to think of a mode is to think of it in terms of another. To think of the definition of mode, which presupposes there's another on which it depends. But this other brings in numerical notions, which we cannot eliminate from the notion of mode. And so because the notion of number is in a way improper for Spinoza, and because the notion of mode presupposes the notion of number, the notion of mode is going to be incoherent in a way, sort of invented by the mind. So in that respect, there's evidence for an idealist reading. But it is not the case with regard to substance or attributes. There's any kind of number presupposed in the notion of substance and attributes. And that's why the Wolfsonian reasons for idealism with regard to attributes won't hold up, although it is reason for idealism with regard to modes. I'll leave it there for now, and we can discuss more.
Thank you. And now we'll have a few words from our commentator, Pascal Sévérac, from the University of Paris Est.
Merci. Thank you very much. Alors, ma réponse, vous l'avez en fait en français et ensuite en anglais. In French and in English. Alors, Michael Della Rocca travaille la pensée spinoziste avec un point de vue, qui est un point de vue radical au double sens du terme. Radical parce qu'il porte sur la racine, le fondement même du système, à savoir sur la nature même de l'être, et radical aussi parce que Michael adopte une position forte et originale sur l'ensemble du système philosophique, à savoir, c'est là la thèse générale, que Spinoza est un idéaliste. La thèse générale de Michael Della Rocca est que, chez Spinoza, tout ce qui existe est dépendant de la pensée. Tout ce qui existe est mind-dependent. Alors, il faudra peut-être que Michael nous explique cela, comment un mode, comment un corps, par exemple, est mind-dependent. Mais cette thèse forte, et on va dire dans laquelle Michael persévère, cette thèse a été développée dans ses nombreuses recherches, en soutenant notamment que l'être, chez Spinoza, est tout entier soumis au PSR, Principle of Sufficient Reason, principe de raison suffisante. Et aujourd'hui, Michael Della Rocca développe une propriété de cet idéalisme, à savoir qu'on ne peut qu'improprement parler de pluralité, meniness, autant pour les attributs que pour les modes, puisque les uns comme les autres ne se distinguent pas en eux-mêmes ou par eux-mêmes, mais simplement, seulement, du point de vue d'un esprit qui les perçoit. Michael Della Rocca précise toutefois aussitôt qu'il serait tout aussi impropre d'affirmer que les attributs sont un ou identiques entre eux, comme il serait impropre d'affirmer que les modes ne sont pas plusieurs. En fait, pas plus que Dieu, ni les attributs, ni les modes, ne se peuvent compter. Mais si Michael Della Rocca se range aux côtés des lectures de Hegel et de Wolfson, avec bien sûr quand même un certain écart, une critique notamment de Wolfson, mais une critique qui réhabilite quand même la thèse générale de Wolfson sur l'idéalisme de Spinoza, si donc Michael Della Rocca se range aux côtés des grandes lectures de Hegel et de Wolfson sur Spinoza, c'est que selon lui, une seule chose dans la philosophie spinoziste peut être dite au sens propre, exister, c'est Dieu. À savoir Dieu, ce qui signifie non pas qu'un Dieu existe, mais seulement que Dieu existe. Les attributs aussi existent, mais dire les attributs existent, c'est peut-être déjà trop, ou même un attribut existe, ce serait déjà impropre. On devrait dire simplement attribut, ça existe, comme on dit Dieu existe. Quant au mode, puisque en concevoir un signifie nécessairement concevoir une altérité à partir de laquelle le mode est conçu, soit en fait un autre mode, soit Dieu plus profondément, modifié par un mode ou Dieu dans sa nature absolue. Et puisque cette altérité implique une pluralité qu'on ne peut qu'improprement affirmer, du coup, on ne peut proprement affirmer que tel ou tel mode existe. Une telle assertion, le mode A existe, est une assertion incohérente, selon Michael, qui renoue donc bel et bien avec la thèse hegelienne d'un acosmisme spinoziste. Acosmisme au sens où aucune modalité ne se distingue véritablement de l'être divin. Alors devant des thèses aussi fortes, aussi radicales, je formulerai pour Michael quatre questions. La première consiste ou porte, on va dire, sur cette question de l'idéalisme en général. D'abord, il faut souligner donc l'originalité de la position de Michael, surtout dans le paysage européen. Originalité d'autant plus grande qu'on soutient en général plutôt le contraire sur Spinoza, à savoir que Spinoza est un matérialiste. Alors quand je dis « on soutient », je vais en fait donner des noms. Quand je dis « on », je pense à Vittorio Morfino, par exemple, en Italie, ou encore à Pierre-François Moreau, même s'il n'est pas là, en France. Pour ce dernier, en effet, pour Pierre-François Moreau, Spinoza peut être qualifié de matérialiste, non pas au sens où il réduirait la pensée à l'étendue, ou au sens où il réduirait l'esprit à une émanation ou à une fonction du corps, mais au sens où Spinoza appliquerait à la pensée les mêmes principes de connaissance que ceux qu'il applique à l'étendue. Naturalisation du psychisme, principe de la causalité déterministe, recherche des lois de la pensée qui font que la pensée, si vous voulez, est une matière aussi consistante, est une matière aussi consistante que la matière étendue elle-même. Spinoza, le matérialiste, développerait ainsi une physique de la pensée, pour reprendre la belle formule de François Zurabichvili, une physique de la pensée comme il jette les bases d'une physique de l'étendue. Du coup, ma première question à Michael serait la suivante. Plutôt que d'idéaliste, Spinoza ne peut-il être qualifié de matérialiste, au sens non seulement où l'esprit est étudié comme un matériau, au même titre que le corps, comme un phénomène naturel, mais aussi au sens, et là j'ajouterai un point, au sens où il n'y a pas d'esprit sans corps, c'est-à-dire pas d'esprit qui ne soit idée du corps. Autrement dit, ne peut-on pas dire avec beaucoup plus de certitude, non pas que les choses sont mind-dépendantes, mais que le mind est body-dépendante. Alors on verra que cette dépendance n'est pas une relation causale, mais que pour comprendre la puissance d'un esprit, il faut comprendre la puissance d'un corps. Donc c'est l'explication au fond de ce que peut un esprit qui passe par l'explication de ce que peut un corps. Même si bien sûr, on le sait, il n'y a pas d'interaction causale entre esprit et corps. Deuxième question concernant l'essence chez Spinoza. Michael de la Rocca distingue trois critères pour pouvoir dénombrer une ou plusieurs choses, pour pouvoir dire qu'elles sont soit une, soit qu'elles sont plusieurs. Premier critère, il faut que cette chose ou ces choses existent. Deuxième critère, il faut qu'elles existent toutes seules ou en un certain nombre, x ou y. Et troisième critère, il faut qu'elles soient de même nature que d'autres choses qui peuvent également exister. Or, comme le remarque très bien Michael, la définition de l'essence, dans la deuxième partie de l'éthique, pose une stricte réciprocité, on pourrait dire aussi qu'il y a une distinction seulement de raison, une stricte réciprocité entre la chose et sa propre essence. Ce qui appartient à une essence est donné si la chose est donnée. Et si ce qui appartient à l'essence est supprimé, la chose est supprimée. Et, réciproquement, la chose est donnée si ce qui appartient à son essence est donné. Du coup, comment comprendre que deux choses puissent être de même nature? Mais ça, c'est une question que je pose à Michael, mais qu'on pourrait aussi poser à Spinoza. Comment comprendre que deux choses puissent être de même nature, puisqu'une nature de choses est propre à chaque chose en question? Ce critère de la communauté d'essence a-t-il encore un sens? Alors la solution est peut-être que toutes les choses qui existent ne sont pas singulières. Il faudrait revenir sur le nominalisme spinoziste. Mais qu'il en existe qui sont spécifiques. Par exemple, l'essence de l'homme, la nature humaine, ne serait-elle pas une essence spécifique? Et une essence de choses qui existent. On n'a sans doute jamais rencontré l'homme, la nature humaine, mais en même temps, ça ne signifie pas qu'elle serait un simple être de raison. Et la question annexe, Michael assimile dans le cours de sa démonstration le fait que deux choses conviennent en nature avec le fait qu'elles aient la même nature. Ma question, c'est, est-ce qu'il ne faudrait pas faire une petite distinction entre convenir en nature et avoir la même nature ? N'y a-t-il pas une distinction à faire entre les deux, au sens où, par exemple, deux hommes rationnels pourraient convenir en nature, en tant qu'ils raisonnent, et même faire un individu plus fort, même si la nature du premier individu, dans sa complexité également passionnelle, n'est pas identique à la nature du second. Troisième question, c'est sur la méthode d'analyse de la pensée spinoziste. L'une des grandes idées du spinozisme, mais là je m'avance peut-être, c'est, me semble-t-il, de toujours penser ensemble identité et différence. L'identité et la différence se pensent de façon conjonctive, jamais disjonctive chez Spinoza. Ainsi en va-t-il de la différence entre les attributs, dont Spinoza précise qu'elle est réelle, donc chaque attribut se pense indépendamment l'un de l'autre, mais qu'elle se pense, cette différence, à même l'identité substantielle. C'est là l'énoncé du Scoli, de la position 10 de la partie 1 qu'a convoqué Michael. Bien que deux attributs soient conçus comme réellement distincts, donc on a l'affirmation de la distinction réelle, mais à l'intérieur d'une concessive, c'est-à-dire l'un sans l'aide de l'autre, pourtant nous ne pouvons pas en conclure qu'ils constituent deux entités, entia, ou deux substances différentes. Ainsi également de l'identité, ce coup-ci, entre l'esprit et le corps. L'identité entre l'esprit et le corps, elle est affirmée et réaffirmée, mais elle est affirmée dans la différence attributive, dont Spinoza nous dit qu'ils constituent, esprit et corps, une seule et même chose, mais qui se pensent à même la différence des attributs. 3-2 Scoli, par exemple. Ainsi encore, on pourrait multiplier les exemples, de la différence entre nature naturante et nature naturée. C'est une différence, mais qui se conçoit dans l'identité d'une seule et même substance, d'une seule et même nature. Ainsi encore, de la différence entre l'esprit et la conscience. Là, on pourrait en discuter, mais l'esprit comme idée et la conscience comme idée d'idée, c'est une différence, mais une différence qui se conçoit à même l'identité modale, puisqu'il n'y a qu'une seule et unique idée. Il n'y a qu'une seule idée qui soit idée d'objet, c'est-à-dire idée d'un corps, esprit en tant qu'être objectif, ou objet d'idée, idée de soi, esprit en tant qu'essence ou être formel. Je termine. Spinoza lui-même le dit, pour former une idée adéquate, il faut que soit perçue une pluralité de choses en même temps. Et donc la contemplation d'une pluralité simultanée est en effet la condition d'une intellection des convenances, différences, oppositions. Or, penser ensemble identité et différence est selon moi une manière de concevoir plusieurs choses simultanément, et nous pouvons en tirer une conséquence pour ce qui me concerne ici, l'impropriété du nombre pour Dieu, pour les attributs, pour les modes, c'est-à-dire l'impropriété des affirmations « Dieu est un », les attributions plurielles, tel mode existe, une telle impropriété ne pourrait-elle pas se transformer en véritable propriété dès lors que sont affirmées l'unité et la pluralité ensemble, c'est-à-dire de façon non exclusive. C'est-à-dire dès lors qu'on affirme « Dieu est un » en tant qu'il est constitué d'une infinité d'attributs. Les attributs sont en nombre infini en tant qu'ils constituent l'essence d'une même substance, etc. Donc la troisième question sur la méthode pourrait s'énoncer ainsi. Le point de vue purement analytique convient-il pour comprendre une réalité elle-même synthétique, dont la complexité est synthétique? Quatrième et dernière question, très rapidement. Admettons que le spinozisme soit un idéalisme, c'est-à-dire que toute réalité existante soit bien indépendante. Quelles conséquences en tirer d'un point de vue éthique et d'un point de vue politique? Bon, si je voulais jouer sur les mots, je dirais que Michael de la Roquette nous apprend que Dieu s'aime sans compter, ou qu'il faut l'aimer sans compter. Mais allons plus loin, affirmer que le spinozisme est un matérialisme, au sens où je l'ai précisé plus haut, a peut-être des conséquences éthiques et politiques fortes, notamment sur l'usage qu'on peut faire de Spinoza dans une éthique ordinaire, en amour, en amitié, en société, ou aussi, plus académiquement, dans l'usage qu'on peut faire du spinozisme en rapport avec les sciences sociales, avec les neurosciences. Mais si le spinozisme est un idéalisme, cela a-t-il, selon Michael, des conséquences pour un usage de la pensée de Spinoza? Puisque Spinoza a écrit une éthique, que signifie au fond que cette éthique soit idéaliste? Merci. Merci.
Now, I think that since Pascal has presented several questions for Michael, We need to start with Michael having an opportunity to reply briefly to those. However, we are behind schedule, so I'll ask you to be very brief.
I'll be very brief. Pascal, those are wonderful questions. I can't answer them all right now. But I want to just mention a couple of points. I like the way you put it that we shouldn't use the definite article or the indefinite article. We shouldn't even say that attribute sa exists, that exists. The demonstrative there, I think, is going to be a problem too. So we say attribute exists or exist. I mean, I hate to use a singular or plural even, but I wouldn't say that exists. I agree that the same principles that apply to understanding extension, the same kind of laws, the strictness of laws, apply to thought as well. This is part of what Spinoza's naturalism involves, and so I think that's really important to see, as you point out. So there's a parallelism of laws and strictness of laws. So thought can be understood just as strictly as extension can be understood. And in a way that means that thought is dependent on extension, but only in a way, because I would say this, that for each idea there's for each body, there's an idea of that body. For each idea, there's a corresponding body. But the fact that there's an idea of a particular body, that doesn't depend on bodies at all in any sense. It doesn't depend on extension in any sense. The idea of a body depends on other ideas of bodies all the way down. So in a way, extension's involved in the thought of bodies, but that doesn't make for any kind of dependence of extension, any kind of dependence of thought on extension. Rather, thoughts about bodies depend on other thoughts about bodies. But still, I want to affirm the naturalism down the line. I won't answer the other questions except to say that I think the question about the ethical implications of this kind of idealist reading are exactly the right ones to raise. I'm very grateful that you raised that. And that's connected with your point about identity and difference. I think identity is okay as far as substance is concerned and attributes are concerned. Difference is how we do have to understand modes, but because difference is problematic for Spinoza, there's something inherently problematic about modes.
Okay. Now, I must recognize some of the hands. I think Yitzhak and Moens and Allison and Mark, and we've got as many as we can do, I think.
You have to come here.
I'll repeat your question.
Quickly, I think it's a great paper, it's bold and fun, but I thought that was on its domestication project, and I suspect this one as well. I'll explain quickly 2 points why. First of all, Spinoza clearly criticizes the concept of number, right? But never the concept of quantity per se. On that, precisely, the letter 12, or precisely you have the boldest attack on number. You say that number can be conceived by the imagination and the intellect, and it is conceived by the intellect as infinity. And infinity is real. There is not the slightest indication in Spinoza that infinity is not real. More than that, infinity is quantitative, right? So it must be, and you see that when Spinoza is using, at the end of letter 12, is using Kreska's argument for infinity, he's arguing for actual infinity, which is not only quantitative, but very strongly quantitative. So any kind of attempt to, you know, to erase infinity and say, well, it's just the same as quantity and number, finite number, I don't think it's going to work. Second point.
Afterward.
Okay. So Itzik, you're saying that number is bad, perhaps, for Spinoza, but quantity is okay. And I think I'm open to that, right? One of the things that I've been tempted to, and this is part of my first response to Pascal, is that substance should be like a mass term, not a count noun. I mean, that's one way of putting it. So that there's a quantity of substance, there's a quantity of attributes. That might be okay, because quantity doesn't presuppose number necessarily, right? So I think that I might be able to respond to you in that way.
Okay, Mons?
Okay, so I'm going to be very, very brief. So I'm a little bit confused about your notion of proper and improper. What is the propriety, a feature of? Is it of the mind? Is it a way of thinking? Is it epistemological categories? Are these semantic categories something that This has to do with the sentences, has this to do with the concept. What is the propriety and the impropriety?
That's a really good question. What's the propriety attached to and the impropriety attached to? It's a way of proper and improper ways of speaking, ways of thinking, perhaps also. I think it attaches to, it's an epistemological linguistic category, I think. I'm not sure what follows from that, whether that's a bad implication or not, but I think it's proper and improper ways of speaking. As Spinoza himself says, that improperly speaking, etc.
Okay, Allison.
I think my question dovetails nicely with Mon's. I was wondering about many eyes. So you think that the attributes, it's true that the attributes are many eye.
In the improper sense, yes.
In the improper sense, yes. What makes that true? So the criteria for many eye that they X and Y exist, that they're not one and the same P, and that it's not the case that they're of the same nature. So there's only one positive criterion there, which is that they exist.
Exactly.
But you say it's not inadequate, it's improper linguistic epistemological category, but it's not an inadequate way of, it's not an inadequate idea that the attributes are many I. So what is it sort of glomming onto in the world? What is it about those things besides that they exist that makes them many I?
And that's it. That's all that they're glomming onto, right?
They exist.
That's right. So many eyes is kind of a loose way of talking, right? It does dovetail nicely with Mohan's question. It's a loose way of talking. Really, what we should be saying is God, right? Extension, right? That's all we should be saying, and not trying to be finer about it than that, right? So the positive content of the claim that the attributes are many eye is just really the claim that the attributes exist. Right, and then there are these things that are true also. It's not the case that they are one and the same P. It's not the case that they are of the same nature. But those are negative claims, right? The positive content of any claim is that God exists or attributes exist.
Okay, Martin and then Dan, and I don't go beyond that right now.
Really fun paper, and I enjoyed the comments as well. I'm worried that your attack on the reality or the existence of the modes is going to apply equally well to substance. So your central line of attack here is the notion of in alio, being in another, is numbers presupposing notion. It seems to me, for exactly the same reasons, causa sui, in se est, these are also number presupposing notions, if in alio is, so is in se est. And then God doesn't exist, substance doesn't exist, and you've turned Spinoza into some kind of Buddhist
Well, that may not be so bad. I mean, I would say, I grant that my interpretation is flirting with some kind of nihilism, which is historically important. But I think there's an important difference between alio as it figures in the definition of modes. I think that what you said is that in the definition of substance is in itself. Being in itself doesn't presuppose another. Right, so there's a purely positive perhaps, right, but not in the sense that identity presupposes other. Right, this is where I think I'm disagreeing with one point that Pascal makes, that you can understand identity of substance, what it is to be a substance, without presupposing the notion of otherness. So it's a purely positive conception of being, and so in se doesn't presuppose another, a multiplicity, in the way that in another does, in the case of modes. So I want to differentiate positive conceptions like substance from the conception of modes still.
Okay.
You have to speak on the microphone because we can't register if you don't speak with the microphone.
Michael, thank you for a very interesting and challenging paper. But if I understand your definition of one P,
yes,
and one I, it seems to me that Dan Garber comes out as one in exactly the same sense as God is. There is only one.
Exactly.
My nature. So you wouldn't say Dan Garber. You couldn't use. Well, it seems to me that seems to be rather strange to say that I am unique in the same sense that God is.
And don't sell yourself short. I think you're really, be positive here. I think that I didn't get to that part of the paper really, but so Dan Garber is one in the improper sense. God is one in the improper sense. That's right, and that's because I think for Spinoza, everything has a unique essence. Even you have a unique essence. And that's what prevents you from being innumerable, just as God is. So both you and God are one in the improper sense, and both you and God are not one in the proper sense. So, however, you're worse off than God, because what it is for Dan Garber to exist presupposes otherness, the definition of mode, and what it is for God to exist doesn't presuppose otherness. So that's the respect in which God is better off than you. But that's the only respect, that God does not presuppose otherness in God's definition. You presuppose otherness in your definition. And otherness is where the problem lies. And that's not just your problem, it's everyone. Yeah.
So I think we could take one more, but we would ask you to come forward and use the microphone.
You're still pretty close, Dan. You
Thanks.
Shall I put it in French or
English?
English.
Okay. On the contrary, Pascal, I take seriously the idealistic perspective. But my question is, if every reality is mind-dependent, what is this mind? I mean, from a reality point of view, can you qualify it a little bit more? Is it mode? Is it the substance itself? Thinking?
Okay, a good question. I think every reality is thought dependent, and the thought there is just the attribute of thought, or the thinking substance.
So it's not mind dependent, actually.
It's well, if you think of minds as finite minds, that's correct, right? So what's ultimately finite minds are not ultimately real. There's the incoherence that Dan Garber, you know, involves in his very concept, right? And the rest of us, and the rest of us do, right? So it's all thought dependent. I wouldn't say mind dependent.
Yes, yeah. Fine. Okay. Oh, because I was thinking about the response of Pascal Gillot yesterday,
yes.
Dealing with the mind as a process of thinking.
Right.
Or thought as a process of thinking, and subject of thinking like minds, or like, you know what?
Right.
In the Cartesian sense, so best to know of your position.
Right. So in answer to that, I mean, so part of my answer to Pascal here is about identity and difference, right? So I think that modes have to be understood in terms of processes, in terms of difference, right? Modes are defined in terms of each other, partly. And that's essential to understanding modes, right? But that notion of differentiation and processes that modes by their nature involve, that's what involves them in problems, because we can't fully make sense of that kind of enumeration there. Right.
Okay. I agree with that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, I think then we'd better thank our speakers.